Hi, I'm Kerry Vest, and I'd like to welcome you to the secret world of real-world fiber optics and CAT5 cabling. I'm going to demystify this little notion of how secret fiber optics can be. Hopefully, you'll get a clear view after seeing this video as to what it really takes to connectorize and test fiber optics. Getting to how prevalent fiber optics has become over the past 5, 6, 7 years. While I was out in California about 5, 6 years ago, I was going through a certification class for fiber optics, and I happened to notice that there were a lot of ex-PAC bellmen in this class. Come to find out, these repairmen, these phone guys, had taken their early retirement package that the company was offering at that time, and going right into class and right out of the class and right into the working world again. So they got their retirement packages, all their benefits, and didn't miss a lick. It was just a semester course. So for 4 months worth of schooling, they were right back out. So they really got a sweet deal on that one. Okay, I'd like to show you right off exactly what we're talking about as far as the fiber optics is concerned. I'll go ahead and strip this, and you can see some of the components inside here. When you're cutting this stuff, you just want to score the cable. You don't really want to cut through it, because this will snap right off. As you can see, I kind of cut through this. I went a little too deep with it. So you really want to be careful about what you're doing, because with a sharp knife, you can cut right through the Kevlar. That's what this yellow stuff is right here, and right into the fiber itself. So be extremely careful. Now, this Kevlar is a real strong fibrous component. It's actually used in bulletproof vests for the police department. Okay, so you can actually, if you want to pull this, use this as a pull when you're pulling it through the inner duct, through your inner duct or through pipe or whatever. You can actually strip this back to the Kevlar, cut off the fibers, which are these right here, and use the Kevlar as a puller. These are your fibers. This is a 6-strand. As you can see, this is color-coded. Okay, this is a multi-mode fiber, and multi-mode is used for short runs. Okay, this is the coatings on the outside of this blue fiber, you can see. I'm going to go ahead and strip some of this off with my Miller strippers. This is what I'm comfortable with in using. There are several different kinds. You can see it comes right off that coating. And if you can get a close-up here, and I don't know if you're going to be able to see this because it's the size of one human hair. Let me see if I can tilt it the right way there, maybe. You can see right here, that's your fiber. Now, this is measured in microns, okay? So this typically multimode, we customarily use a 62.5 micron, which is the size of your core, okay? The interior diameter there, over 125, which is the size, the outside diameter of the actual fiber itself. There are several different kinds of, there are several different makes of diameters in the core size of multimode fiber. Included with the 62.5 is the 50, the 85, and we have, that's with a 125 cladding, which is the exterior, like I just said. We have one more that isn't produced too much anymore, and that's a 100 micron diameter core with a 140 micron exterior cladding. You don't see that too much because of the low bandwidth. There really isn't much there. So this is multi-mode fiber. Your single mode fiber are for long haul applications, and that's got an 8.5 micron diameter core with a 125 cladding, same as the multimode. Now, one of these fibers is the equivalent of 900 pair of a 900 pair cable. And that's quite an amazing feat for fiber. I think technology is still gearing up to utilize exactly those amounts of pairs, one single strand. So when it gets to that point, you're really going to see some amazing stuff, I think. So when you're pulling, let's get to pulling here. We're going to discuss that a little bit. The first thing you want to do when you're pulling in fiber is to place your interduct. I don't have a piece on the table here with me, but an interduct is a rigid plastic pipe. You can buy it an inch, inch and a quarter, inch and a half, 2 inch, whatever the size. It's about the same size as rigid pipe. You want to place that in there first. You really don't want to pull fiber, any fiber for that matter, without putting some kind of protective, in some kind of protection. So your rigid interduct is the way to go. It comes with a string inside the interduct, so once you've placed your interduct, you can go ahead and tie on your fiber to the string and pull it right through the interduct, and everything will be great. Also helps get around certain corners, this rigid interduct, so that if you were to pull, for instance, if you were to try to pull this without any interduct or anything like that, and you're pulling around a real sharp bend, you run the risk of possibly breaking your fiber, which is really a drag. So get your interduct in, tie it up, pull it through. It's great. Now we want to get into the different types of styles of pulling. If you're pulling, for instance, if you're pulling outdoor cable, real thin outdoor cable, a lot of flexibility to it, and there are different styles and types. I have one here. It's got a this is an outdoor flooded cable. It's called a mini bundle. I have a little bit already broken out. These mini bundles carry roughly anywhere from 6 to 12 fibers in each bundle. As you can see, they're all color-coded also. Blue, orange, green, brown. Okay. Now this doesn't have, as you can see, this is a central strength member, this is called. This gives it a little bit of rigidity. However, it doesn't have a real thick outer coating like some other outdoor fibers. So you really want to take note. If you really got a long haul and you're really going some long spans with this stuff, you really should take into consideration perhaps the type of coating, the outside coating that's on this. You may want a little bit tougher, a little bit more rigid cabling for something like that. It'll lessen the risk of maybe kinking back on itself or some other crazy thing that might hurt the fiber or cable. So when you're pulling this through, for instance, several manholes, if you're going from campus style environment where you're running it from building to building to building to building, and there are several manholes that you've got to go through underground, the best way to pull this stuff is to go to the center point of where you're going to, between the two points where they're going to end up. Set yourself up there, pull one end in first, okay, and then what you want to do is take the rest of it off the reel and try to get it into a figure eight right there where you're going to be dumping it right back into the manhole, okay? And the reason for that is pretty obvious. So you really don't want to pull this a mile down the road, stretch it out across seven different driveways, and expect it not to get damaged with trucks rolling over, so on and so forth. So you really want to just take it off the reel and put it into a nice little figure eight. Just lay it into a figure eight as best as you can. And most of the time, this stuff comes off and it lays right down in that style anyway. It's really pretty easy. And then once you come to the end off that spool, it just comes right off the top of the pile, the figure eight. It's really easy. One man can stand there and feed your cable and watch the figure eight at the same time without having to worry it getting all kinked up and everything. So that's very important to keep that in mind. When you kink this stuff, and I've got a little story about this, it's, you really have to watch it. And another thing to remember is the style or the type of coating that you have. I did a job out in California at a hospital where we were pulling this, it was a white hard plastic outside coating, and it was fairly rigid, and it looked nice, but we soon discovered that if you didn't really watch it as you were pulling through the ceilings, if there was a loop in here and we pulled the loop tight, this here, you really can't pull this too tight without getting it hung up on something, and it's not really going to pull, pull itself shut. So this is not bad stuff, but the stuff we were using, like I say, it had a real hard plastic, and when we pulled it around a corner, it had a loop in it. The hard plastic, when it finally gave way, it acted exactly like a knife and sliced through 24 fibers, and we ended up having to cut it right there at that spot, fusion splicing everything together so that the customer had the least amount of loss from one end to the other. A very time-consuming process. So there are certain things that you should be aware of. That type of, I can't give you the manufacturer's name, I really can't remember right off the top of my head, but it's white, I remember that. So keep the style of the protective coating that you have in mind, and you'll be in good shape. Another thing about this outdoor fiber, you can only bring that into a building 50 feet. That's law, okay? Because of its compound, the flooding compound that is used to protect this from the elements on the outside, it's a petroleum base. So if it were to catch on fire, for instance, inside the building, it's not so much that it's combustible as it is the toxicity, that the fumes, it's very toxic. So if it catches on fire, this stuff really gives off some nasty fumes. Unless, of course, it's running directly into the building, into hard, rigid pipe conduit from as soon as it comes in all the way to wherever it has to go. That's the only way that you're allowed to bring outdoor fiber all the way beyond 50 feet. So keep that in mind when you're walking through a job. Now, one of the other things that I'd like to show you is the bend radius on some of this. Give you an indication as to what you can get away with and what you cannot get away with. You can actually, with this indoor fiber, and it, once again, it depends on how many fibers you have inside each bundle. Obviously, if you get some of the bigger cables, like 24 fiber cable or a 72 fiber cable or 144 fiber, so on and so forth, the bigger your bend radius has to be. You get it to a point where you think you can put a couple of loops in this for a service loop, you know, before you put your fiber up into your enclosure. Okay, you've got yourself a service loop. This is actually a little too tight. You know, you really don't want anything quite so small. Reason being, it's not breaking anything, but you're starting to constrict or impede your signal. Okay, so you want something a little bit bigger than that. Typically, 6 to 8 inches across here. Okay, that's what I use. And right about like that should be fine. Okay, well, you've got 6 to 8 inches across the diameter here. Now, the underground fiber is a different animal altogether when you're putting in a service loop or giving them some excess. And once again, it's the service loop is for your own protection and the customer's. If you were to break the fiber while you were connectorizing it, or maybe you closed the door on it, or maybe somebody came in and bumped the table while you were working on it and busted your fiber, you would need this excess in order to pull up some extra and continue on with your job. Now, getting back to this, your outdoor fiber has this central strength member in here, so it's not going to give you a real tight bend radius. You know, you're going to have to give yourself a good a good foot and a half across. Let me show you here. I've already stripped some back here, as you can see. But this is typical of this type of fiber, how much you can get away with as far as your bend radius is concerned. You don't want to get too much smaller than this, because then you can start here. You can actually hear it crack inside as you're bearing down. You can hear it start to crack. So you don't want to. It's common sense, you know. You can feel it. You don't want to have to be able to hold it tight with one hand and grit your teeth and put a tie wrap around it. If you have to do that, you've got yourself too small. Okay. So you want to make it nice, easy loop. All right. And then tie wrap it off to your ladder rack or just below the enclosure where you're going to be going into. All right, getting back to the diameters, I want to explain a little bit, show you a picture. I got away from that a little bit. This is when you're looking at the end of a connector, a finished connector, this is basically what you're going to see. You know, okay, a good connector. This is your core, and this will be blackened unless there's some light coming in from the other end, of course. But this is your outside diameter, like I was discussing a little bit earlier. This is your cladding, your outside. That's called cladding. And the core. This is 62.5 for multi-mode, 8.5 for single mode. And single mode and multi-mode both have a 125 micron cladding. Okay, so that's that. Now, if we could just pan into what I've got set up already here. Okay, this is what it would look like. This is your enclosure. This is your LIU, your light guide enclosure. This is AT&T. They make pretty good stuff. This is your service loop. You want to leave typically around, I'd say, 15 to 20 feet if you can. Okay. Once again, it's not only for your protection, but for the customer's protection. I've run into situations where they accidentally put the LIU, the enclosure, and brought in the fiber onto the wrong wall. All the outlets for their hardware were directly underneath this, so they had to move this other side of the room in order to get their equipment where this was. So if you had just brought it directly in without any kind of a service loop, people are going to be a little irate, because now you have no way to move this, and it's not going to sit well. So always leave yourself a little bit of slack whenever possible, whether it's up in the ceiling or directly on the wall underneath your LIU or above the LIU. It doesn't make any difference, but this really is important. These couplers, I'll talk a little bit about this enclosure here. You want to bring up your fiber. You can tie wrap it off to this little wing right here. Okay, these are your couplers. This is what you're gonna, after you're finished connectorizing the fiber, this is what you're gonna hook up to. Okay. Now, to put this together, these all come in pieces. You can also buy them preloaded. I recommend if you're on a big job, and naturally your profit margin is going to be big for any kind of fiber. You'd be amazed at the prices of some of this stuff, and what the profit margin is involved here. It's truly amazing. It's well worth your while to get involved. That's, if for nothing else, the profit. You can buy these preloaded, like I said. If you're on a big job, your profit margin should be as such to have these preloaded, buy these preloaded. So whoever's doing the fiber, if you're doing the fiber, you don't have to mess around putting all this stuff together, okay, because that is truly a time-consuming part of it, more of an aggravation than anything else. Okay, that's that. Why don't I go ahead and strip this. You see how the service loop is. You see where it goes up into the LIU. I'll go ahead and give you a demonstration right here, right now, as to how to strip this, how to cut back the Kevlar, and put a connector on. Once you've got everything tied up in here, okay, everything's connected to the wall, you want to go ahead and just bend it back a little bit, score the cable. Okay. And all you need to do after that is to just, once you've scored it, you can just bend it a little bit. Looks like I haven't scored it quite enough. You can just bend it. Well, this is tough stuff. Okay, and it should just snap right off. Now, you want to pull this jacketing off. I think you're going to have to pan directly to me here to see the rest of this, yeah? To pull this jacketing off, you don't want to pull back against the actual fiber. You want to pull with the fiber. The actual strength of this fiber is pretty good. As I recall, I was taught that it was 500 pounds per square inch, which is pretty tough if you're pulling with it. Against it, obviously, it's going to bust just like that. So you want to be careful how you pull this jacketing off. Now you can just keep one hand down here, and if you just pull ever so slightly, it'll slide right off. You're going to have to pull from the end, though, as you're pulling this off. There you go. Okay, now you've got your fiber, and all you're dealing with is the Kevlar. Now it's wrapped, this Kevlar is wrapped in like a clockwise manner or counterclockwise manner around the fiber itself for the protection. You want to just kind of untwist it. Okay, that'll get the twist out. You can shake the fiber. And as you can see, that Kevlar just kind of falls right off as you're shaking the fiber. And if it doesn't, just blow on it. The strands or the actual Kevlar will fall right off as you blow on it. Okay? Once you've got that Kevlar separated, you just hang on to the Kevlar. And I always recommend counting your fibers because I've done it, and I know probably several other people have done it. They have accidentally left one of the fibers inside the Kevlar, and if it gets buried inside there and you don't check, you cut that Kevlar, you're cutting off a whole fiber. And once again, getting back to the service loop, which is your protection as well as the customer's, you want to have that just in case something unfortunate such as cutting that fiber off happens. So I've got some side cutters here. I recommend using your side cutters. They stay sharp, okay, for a long period of time. You use telephone scissors, or you've probably all seen these types of scissors. It doesn't take long for these to dull up. I've gone through, when I've been on some big jobs, I've gone through two or three pair of these things within 2 weeks' time. That's how dull they get. Cut anything with them. So stick with your side cutters, cut the Kevlar. Okay. Now this stuff is still wound around. You can shake it. Okay. You can see that Kevlar just falling right off. You just shake the fiber. You can help it off eventually once it gets down to the end. But I have found that if you try to pull this stuff, that Kevlar, off the fiber from way up here, it's so fibrous, it knots up on your fiber. Now you ended up having to take this fiber out one strand at a time out of this knot that you've created with the Kevlar. So be aware of that. Try to just be real loose with the Kevlar as it's coming off the strands. Don't try to force that Kevlar off because it will bind up over your fiber. Okay, I'm using here an ATT connector. Okay, some of the tools that are required, as you can see on my table, are some strippers. I use Miller strippers. Okay, they're a machined piece of equipment that actually takes the coating, as you saw a little bit earlier, right off, right down to the actual fiber itself. Okay, this is scissors. Got to have scissors. You bust a connector, got to snip it off. tape. Got to have tape for when you're cleaving the tip of or the excess fiber off the connector. Okay, you don't want to just knock that that excess fiber off the tip of your connector any place. Sometimes if you don't scribe it quite enough good, and you just try to knock it off, it can bounce back up into your face, and that's the last place, because it's real hard to get this out of your skin once it's embedded, particularly your eyes. It's real hard to see. You just can't go to a mirror and pull your eyelid down and see a piece of glass in your eye. You'll end up in the hospital. So it's important that you have tape to put your excess fiber onto. Your polishing pucks. Once again, these are AT&T polishing pucks. Once you call up a representative from whatever company you feel comfortable with calling, he'll give you a catalog and you can kind of figure out what it is that you want. But these are typically the kinds of polishing pucks that I use, and they're good ones. Let's see what else. A microscope. Okay, when you're finished polishing, you're going to require a microscope. 100 times is usually pretty good to see the finished product. You're going to want to actually physically see what you've done at the end, because as I'll explain here a little bit later on, there are certain things that you're looking for when you're looking underneath the microscope as to what's a good fiber or what's a good connector and what's a bad connector. So that's that. Tech wipes. You need tech wipes to clean all your fibers with before you, as one of the things that you do as you before you connectorize. You don't want a dirty fiber. You can use this to wipe the face of the connector off when you go from one polishing paper to another polishing paper, and I'll get into that here in just a moment. So tech wipes. This is a very nice piece of cloth to use. It's not real coarse. So you definitely need something like this. You just don't want to use a paper towel to wipe your fiber tip off on the connector base. You can scratch it with just a paper towel. So need tech wipes. Your epoxy. Over the years, it's developed pretty nicely as to the type of glues that you can use to inject inside your connector. This particular epoxy is a quick set. This by itself, there is a primer, which I have here. Okay, this is a two-part epoxy. You have your primer and you have your actual epoxy. This epoxy will set up like after 5-10 minutes. Okay, you dip your fiber into this primer and it sets this up instantly. So we'll get into how much time you have when you dip your fiber tip into the primer to the point where you're trying to get your connector. There is a time limit, not to make you feel rushed or anything, but you're going to have to get some kind of easy motion. And there are steps inside the connector itself. And I'll make a diagram as to what the inside of a connector looks like, because when you're pushing in the fiber, you'll feel a little resistance periodically. And all that is a step that inside the connector body itself, it's made it a little bit difficult. If you run into that step and you can't get past it, well, that primer that you've put on is actually setting up that epoxy. So you haven't got much time. I mean, you got to get past that one little step inside the connector ferrule itself. We'll talk more about that as we go along. The paper, the sandpaper, we have a type A, and this is AT&T. This is actually what does the rough sanding, so to speak, after you scribe the excess fiber off your connector tip. This is what you would use to sand that excess fiber down to the surface of the connector itself, the face of the connector. And then from there, your type C paper, this is what actually polishes the fiber and the fiber face. So this will take down the nub, or the small nub that you have above the connector face, and this polishes it. This actually does the polishing. Okay, I think we've gone through what we have here, what you require to finish the whole job. Oh, the cleaver, the most important, I almost forgot. This is a style cleaver that I like. I've used several over the years, different kinds. There are pens, pen cleavers, and it's all a matter of what you feel comfortable with. I do recommend, though, that you try several different kinds. If you can get some sales representatives from different companies to show you their style of cleavers and just kind of take it out in the field, and if they allow you to use a different style of cleaver, that would be great, because there are some that, like a pen cleaver from AT&T, doesn't, for me anyway, I can't get close enough to the face of the connector when I'm scribing off the excess fiber off the tip. For me, that creates a long polishing process, okay? And when you're out there in the field and you're trying to get as many connectors done as you possibly can, that really eats up a lot of your time. So I prefer this style of cleaver, which, as you can see, if you can pan in here, it's real. You can see this is the actual cutting at here, and it's real flat. This is the connector right here. I can actually sit this right on the face of that connector and cleave off my excess. Okay, so now I've got virtually none as far as a stub is concerned for the excess fiber that I'm cleaving off. Okay, so that's what I prefer. I prefer the flatness of this as opposed to a pen that you can't get down all the way to the surface of the connector face. So that is the cleaver. Now I think I've gone through everything. And with that, we'll put on a connector, step by step. Alcohol. I almost forgot the alcohol. Need the alcohol to clean the connector face off and the fibers themselves. So set everything up. I just pulled apart the connector, and I'll show you the pieces here. Okay, this is an AT&T ST connector. Okay, this boot for our application, there's only a handful, three or four pieces that we're going to be using, and those are the strain relief boot. Okay, that's this piece here. The actual connector itself. And this backing nut, okay? That's all we're going to use. The rest of these pieces in my hand here are for cordage. For instance, if you were going to be making a jumper cordage to go from the outside of your enclosure to the piece of equipment that's running it, like a router, for instance, okay? You need a patch cord to run from the enclosure to the equipment, you would use these extra pieces. And we'll get into that a little bit later on in this video. I'll show you how that connector is put together too. When you're setting yourself up, you want to get yourself on a nice flat surface. What I customarily use is a table. I bought, or actually it was given to me, a table it's a collapsible table with telescopic legs. And it's a projecto stand table is what it's called. I can't think of the manufacturer, but if you go to a business office supply house, for instance, you could probably ask them or inquire with them. I highly recommend it if you're going to be fitting into a lot of these areas that you're going to be doing your fiber in are small or enclosed, IDFs. There isn't a lot of room, but you still need the flat surface and the telescopic legs. You can telescope them up, you know, if you have to stand, if there's no place to sit. So they're real nice. I really recommend those tables. The first thing you want to do here is get your tape. You want to put this tape down because you're going to be catching the excess fiber and putting it on this tape so you know exactly where it's at. Like I say, it's important because I've gotten excess fiber tips stuck in my skin. I've sat on them, you know, just from carelessness on my part. And that's the last thing you really want, believe me. Okay, we've got the connector pieces here. We'll take the blue fiber. You want to strip off the ends. What you want to do with your Miller strippers when you're taking this outside coating off is you want to take off small bites, okay? You really don't want to take off a big hunk. Reason is it's going to catch on that fiber, and all you're going to do is snap that fiber off. Okay, so about a quarter of an inch of a bite, and just take off about three bites. So you're looking at three quarters of an inch to an inch is about all you require. Okay? Once you've got that done, you want to put on your backing nut and your strain relief boot right over the fiber, just like that. Okay, now you want to set that down. You want to pull out your primer. And then you want to dip the tip of your fiber, covering some of the jacketing also. You want to get some of the jacketing on this wet with some of this primer. Okay. Now you can just set it right over there, just like that. Now your connector, you're going to be filling the back end of this connector with your epoxy. So you want to get your needles. I don't think I went over this part of it. You need needles for this style of epoxy, or a syringe. You know, when you're buying consumable kits, which is a kit that has all this stuff, basically all your sandpapers, your needle tips, these two epoxy and the primer, it generally comes with the needle tips or the syringes in order to fill the epoxy. So you've got that. You want to take off that, put this needle tip on, make sure it's down all the way, because if you squeeze real hard, and I've had it happen to me, I've squeezed out a half a bottle of epoxy all over my table. Now you've got to race to the bathroom for towels in order to get the epoxy off your table. Now what I do, as you can see, I've got the needle tip all the way down into this connector. And what I do is I'm looking for, as I'm squeezing the epoxy through, okay, I'm looking for just a dab or a bubble of epoxy on the tip. See, I'm looking down at the tip of this connector, and I can see a bubble of epoxy come out the tip. So you are done. You've got it filled. And as you're drawing your needle out, you want to kind of keep a slight pressure on the epoxy so it fills up the back end of this connector. Now you are ready to slide this on. Okay, you've got your primer on. As soon as you start in this, sliding your fiber through, there might be a step. You might see this. You might see me halt here. Yeah, see it bend? Okay, you just kind of wiggle your fingers back and forth, and it slides right on. Okay, that's one of the ways you can use to get past that step that I was discussing earlier in the video. Because see, it's set up. I'm pulling on the back of this, and it's a done deal. Okay, that's how fast this primer and this epoxy sets up. Now you want to put your boot on. There you go. Put your strain relief boot on. Bring your backing nut up, and that screws right on the back of this. Okay, as you can see, I have approximately, it's over a quarter of an inch of excess of fiber above my connector face. Okay, so we got to get rid of that. Okay, this is something that you're going to have to get used to. It doesn't, some of the pens are cutters or glass cutters, they're diamond tipped. And this is, like I said earlier, is just a real hard plastic. I like the sharpness of it and the fact that you can get right down on the connector face with it when I scribe. But like I say, getting used to this aspect of connectorizing is usually the hardest, only because it doesn't take but just a real light touch when you're scribing across the glass, okay? So this is probably where you're going to end up busting a few of your connectors, because if you press too hard, it's going to break that fiber tip off and it's going to bust down into the ferrule itself, and now you've lost it. I mean, there's no way of getting it back. You just take off your backing nut, your strain relief boot, cut the connector off, start over again. So what you want to do when you're scribing this is just light scribe on one side, turn your connector 180, 180 degree turn, scribe on the other side. Okay, you can put your scriber down, and what I do is I'll lift this fiber tip right off. Okay, I'll just slide my fingers up the ferrule. That's this portion of the connector right here, this porcelain piece, white porcelain piece, and just lift it right off. Okay, you can see the excess is gone, and all there's left is just a real small nub at the on the face of my connector. Take your, you want to keep that fiber, excess fiber, on your finger, okay, and then place it right on the tape. That's what the tape is for. So it's there, you can see it. It's not on a piece of the other table where someone else might be able to walk up, put their hand down, and all of a sudden it's stuck in their skin. It's really painful when you get that excess fiber stuck someplace in your body. It's not pleasant at all. So always be aware of where your excess is going. Okay, the actual polishing process now. What I do is I get myself a tax wipe. Oh, by the way, always cap this stuff after you're finished. I don't know how many bottles I've dumped. You learn the hard way. Get yourself a tax wipe. I fold mine into quarters. You need some alcohol. The recommended is the, 90% isopropyl? I think it's 90%. Anyway, anything less than that might leave a film on your connector face. And if that's the case, it'll deplete the signal also. So you really want a nice, clean connector face after you're finished. Get it nice and wet. Okay. I don't know if I showed you the glass a little bit earlier as one of the pieces that you're going to require as far as equipment is concerned, but you want a nice smooth piece of glass to put your polishing paper down on. You just can't put your polishing paper down on anything. Reason being is the porousness of other materials. As you're polishing, this paper thin polishing paper will, for polishing, the bumps and crevices will protrude right up through your polishing paper. So you're actually polishing over something that's going to affect the integrity of the face of the connector itself, the fiber optics or the fiber face. You will see scratches in it or pits or even breakage. You know, it'll just shatter like a windshield on your car, just a spider web. That's all you'll see when you're looking through a microscope and you're going, what happened here? So you want a nice flat surface, as smooth as possible. If this, every once in a while, you're going to scratch, like I have a couple of scratches in my glass. Thankfully, they're off to the side, so I don't have to worry about them. But even a scratch in the glass, if once you're starting to polish and you hit that scratch, it could break. Okay, so flat and smooth as possible. That's what you want. Now you need your polishing pucks here. I recommend two polishing pucks, one for each paper. For me, it saves me time. If you have to use just one, you start polishing on one paper. Now you've got to wipe everything off on your alcohol and your Tex wipe because you don't want to transfer the polishing grit from one paper to the next paper. So that's just one extra step that I can get rid of by utilizing two polishing pucks. So when you're putting it in the polishing puck, you don't want to push this connector all the way down to its face onto the polishing paper. Okay, you want to just, you can actually lift this, take the puck off, and physically put it in the hole in the puck. Okay, just a little bit. You don't want to push it way through because when you set that polishing puck on your paper, once again, if you've got this connector all the way down to its end, and you can actually see the face of that connector right there, if you've got it pushed all the way through and you place it down on your paper, 10 out of 10 times that fiber tip is going to shatter and break up into your connector. Once again, you've got to cut it off and start all over again. So you want to draw back that connector back just a smidgen. You know, I can't give you in microns what that would be, but it's so that the face of it is not showing, is not flush with your polishing puck. Set it down on your paper. Okay. Generally, the gravity of the connector itself will fall. As you set it down, the gravity or the weightiness of the connector will let it fall to the paper itself. So what you want to do then is just let it and just lightly hold on to the connector itself and start figure eights. You want to do everything as a figure eight in fiber, it seems. This is how you polish. So you've got a nice even polish. You know, if you were to just polish it straight up and down or just in a circle, you would only get a polish on one side of your fiber. The figure eight style ensures that you're polishing everything on the face of that connector. So you just want to do your figure eights. If you're in good light, you know, if you're not in a new construction site and you've got good light, you can actually see on the paper a fine figure eight. That's the glass engraving right into the polishing paper. And as that line widens out, that means that the fiber tip has been polished down to the actual face of your connector. So as soon as you see the line go from a hairline figure eight to a wider figure eight or a wider line as far as the figure eight on your polishing paper is concerned, you know you've gotten that nub all the way down to the surface. If you don't have the light, you can't see it. Once again, this comes back to a touch, and I can't describe it any better than that because you can actually feel it scoring when you're doing your figure eights initially when it's polishing that nub down. And then all of a sudden, it's no resistance whatsoever. And that's what you're trying to check for. That's what you're trying to feel in your fingertips, is that no resistance type of feeling. So those are the two things that you're going to have to keep in mind as you're polishing. One, if you've got the proper light, you'll be able to see the fine line turn into a fatter line, which tells you you've polished down to the face. Number two, if you don't have the light, it's got to be done by feel. Then you're just going to have to, you'll feel that resistance give way to no resistance at all. And that's touch. You'll feel it. You'll know it. So we just do our little figure eights. Thankfully, there's good light here. I can see. Generally, if you've polished, if you've scribed to the point where you don't have a lot of excess to polish down, probably anywhere from 12 to 15 figure eights. If you're doing it, if you're applying just a little bit of pressure, initially when you're polishing, you don't want a lot of pressure down on this connector. Otherwise, you'll snap it right off. But as it's polishing down, you can apply a little pressure downward on the connector, okay? And that's something you'll have to get used to too, because when I first started, I bust a lot of connectors by applying too much pressure down on the connector face itself, and it just snapped it right off. So I'd say anywhere from 13 to 15 revolutions as far as figure eights are concerned. I've gone way over that, but you want to take your connector out, run the face of it through the alcohol on your Tex wipe. So now you're not transferring any of the grit from this polishing paper to this polishing paper. And it's about the same amount of revolutions. Now on this polishing paper, the actual polishing paper, you can apply more pressure because you no longer have that nub to worry about. You can apply a little bit of pressure as you're polishing this. And about the same amount of revolutions. And then you want to wipe it through your Tex wipe. Get your microscope. Put your end in. And check out the damage. Another perfect one. And that's how you put one of these connectors together. Typically, STs are almost all the same. Anywhere you go, whether it's a C-Core, AT&T, AMP, they've got about the same amount of material or components that you have to put together. So that's that. When you're getting ready to put this all together, okay, for instance, if we had these all connectorized, all done, you want to take your patch panel off. Oh, let me show you real quick what a good fiber looks like. This is the overview here of what a good fiber looks like. Okay, this is your core. You can see it's nice and clean. If you were to look at this through a microscope, this is what you're concerned with. And you want to make sure that there aren't any deep pits or scratches, or if it's flaked off in one corner. In other words, if you scribed a little too close in the scriber somehow, when you were pulling up the fiber after you've scribed, it might have just flaked off a little portion of the core. That's not acceptable, okay? And I'll show you a non-acceptable one that demonstrates exactly what I'm talking about here. Now this is the what I was just talking about. This would be the core. If you were to look at this through a microscope, this is your cladding. This is the outside of the, it's the part of the fiber, but this is the middle part that I was describing. This is where I was talking about the flake. If you were to see something such as this, a dark spot on your core, this is not good. You've got some signal loss here, and it'll show up in your tests. At the end of the day, when you go to put your meters on this, you'll see the end result as a bad result. There we go. Okay. Now, this is the good core. If you were to have a sliver taken off here, which happens, believe it or not, quite a bit, because of the way perhaps you've got a sliver of the cladding completely missing right here. That has nothing to do with the core. Your core is still intact. This is perfectly okay. All right, as long as you haven't got something like this, you're looking at this much of the, and that this happens periodically also, where this portion is completely missing because once again of the way you cleave the fiber. Okay, you're going to see a change in your in your loss levels when you put power meters on at the end of the day also here. So if you've got a few slivers missing around the edges, you know, like here and like this one I showed you a little bit earlier, that's okay. You've got a good connector here still. But once you get into the, you've got too much of this cladding off, or you've dipped into the self, or even some real deep scratches all over the core, either you can try to buff these out, and if it doesn't buff out, I really don't recommend that you use that particular connector. You just go ahead and do another one. Okay, that's what that looks like. The difference between good and bad. Now the I want to show you what to use here. They give you a package with this particular LIU. Most of the LIUs have the same type of material involved. These are rings, okay, that you want to place into the LIU, the enclosure. This is what's going to hold your fiber into place. Okay, you've got those in. Now you want to attach your fiber, tie it off here to this little arm here, and secure it. Once again, you don't want to cinch this tie wrap down too tight. You just want to hold it in place, really, because everything on the board here is secured. So you just want to make sure this isn't flopping around in the breeze. Plus, if you don't have it tied, it may fall. If you don't have your fiber secured, it could fall in the door. Someone, and that happens every once in a while. Someone's going to come by and open this door because everybody's curious about what fiber is all about. They want to take a look at it while nobody's looking. One of these loops falls out, or if this isn't tied, maybe it falls down into the door path of the doorway. They close it back up, not realizing it, and that's when they call me out. So make sure it's all tied off. And then you want to start looping your fiber into the panel. Okay? And this can take a little long sometimes because you've got all this excess fiber, but there's a reason for the amount of fiber that I have showing here. This amount is really the appropriate amount that you want to use, only because if you've got this enclosure hanging high up on the wall sometime, you want to be, if there is a problem, if one of the fibers by chance gets busted, like I said earlier, someone getting into this enclosure and closing the door back up on one of the fibers, it's busted. If you can pull that busted fiber down to a tabletop, you're better off. If you've only allowed yourself this much, say you put connectors right here, and you've only allowed yourself a foot and a half, now you've got to get back up on top of a ladder and do all your polishing and everything up on top of a ladder, and that doesn't work. I've been there, I did that, it doesn't work. So what you want to do is make sure that you have plenty, depending on the height of the enclosure, where it goes up on the wall, that you've got enough slack up inside that enclosure that you can pull it all out and bring it down to a tabletop so that you can fix anything that might need to be fixed. So you get all this stuff in. Like I said, it takes a few minutes. This is one of those jobs, I think, that you really don't want an A-type personality doing. It can be tedious, I'll tell you right off the bat. It can be a little tedious at times. I myself have a pretty vivid imagination. Sometimes I've done this so many times I can go to any golf course in the world, play it, be back in time for lunch. So this is where you want to, after you've got everything wound in, Okay, you want to plug your connector into the faceplate. Okay. You snap these in. Close your door. Make sure you cut your tail off your tie wrap. It's a done deal. Looks like. Okay, cordage. I'd like to show you the other half of this connector, the pieces that I told you I'd get back to a little bit later on that I didn't use in this section. Okay, this is what the finished product, I think I showed you what it looked like after it was on. You don't use the strain relief boot, you use this boot. It's a little bit bigger, but it gives it a more finished look. That's what you want to use on cordage. In other words, the patch cord that leads from the outside of your LIU, what you just put into your enclosure, to the equipment that they're hooking up to this fiber optics. Okay? So this is a good connector. And for the sake of this video, we're going to cut it off. This particular strain relief boot, okay, it has the backing nut laminated to it already. It's one whole piece. All right. Naturally, your connector, same connector. And now you're going to be utilizing one of these two pieces. These are just sleeves. These are collars. Okay. This is what, here, let me put them in the palm of my hand. These sleeves, sleeves or collars is what you put on the jacketing. You'll slip this over the jacketing. There's two different sizes here, depending on the thickness of the jacketing of the cable that you're working on. Okay? And they do come in different sizes, the jacketing itself. So you pick out the appropriate eyelet or sleeve, and you place it over your jacketing, and then when you get it to the point of putting the connector on, that sleeve will slip up from the jacketing will actually, you'll slip it on the back of the, okay? So it overlaps, not only it's on the connector, it's on this jacketing also. So when you crimp down, you're crimping the jacketing and the connector together. Okay, not only is it epoxied together, but it'll be crimped together. Okay? So the steps of putting this on, you want to put your strain relief boot on first. You've got that on. Now you choose the appropriate, that's too small, that eyelet. Okay, choose the appropriate sleeve. Get that on. Okay. Now, trimming this back is a little bit different. Let's see, what did I do with my knife? There it is, right in front of me. You want to trim about an inch and a half down on your jacketing, okay? Just want to trim that off. That slides right off, okay? Now you've got your Kevlar, and you don't want to trim that Kevlar all the way down to the jacketing. You want to leave a little bit, about an eighth of an inch to a quarter of an inch of Kevlar, because when we slip this sleeve up to the connector, when it sits on this fiber, this Kevlar is going to take up any additional space between the sleeve and the connector. Okay, when we crimp it on, it's going to be crimping onto not only the outside jacketing, but the Kevlar and the connector body. So you just trim. You want about, like I said, a quarter of an inch of Kevlar left. Okay, so it looks like that. Now I kind of overdid it here. You really don't need this much exposed. I'm going to trim a little bit off. Okay, now when you... This is the jacketing on the actual fiber, the coating on the fiber itself. Okay, when you trim that off, you want to trim it down to about a half an inch above the jacketing on the cable itself. Now I position my, I don't know if I went through this before, I don't think I did, but I position my my stripper, my Miller stripper, at an angle. Okay, it takes that coating off a lot easier. If you try, this is what I have found out. If you try doing it at a right angle to the fiber itself and try stripping it that way, it seems to catch on the fiber and bust the fiber whenever I've done that in the past. So I've been told by other people that if you kind of angle it as you're stripping it, it comes off that fiber a lot easier. So you've got about a half inch of this jacketing on the fiber, okay, left. Now you want to prep it with the primer. Make sure you've got your crimper. Okay, this is the crimper. You go to any AT&T or C-Core or Gray Bar or any number of places, and they'll be able to give you the proper crimper for the proper job. Make sure that's handy. Get your primer. Now you want to dip it into the primer so that it gets the jacketing of the fiber. You want to get that wet with primer, okay? Because when you put the epoxy in the connector, it's got to adhere to this portion of the fiber. So you prime it up. You can set it down there. Take your connector. You're done with your primer. Put it away. Don't want to spill it. Fill the connector of epoxy. Remember, when you're filling it, all you're looking for is at the tip. You're looking for a bead of epoxy. You know you've got enough inside there. Just draw it back a little bit, lighten up on the squeeze, and that fills up the rest of the body of the connector. Now you're ready to put this connector on. This is where it gets a little tricky, okay? You want to get this on and slide this sleeve in your left hand up and over the body of the back end of the connector. So this is what it looks like, okay? You've got that sleeve up there. Now you just want to hold it loosely. Don't let it fall over, you know, down. Sometimes the epoxy might not take right away and your connector might slide off. Don't let that happen. So you take your crimp tool and you want to put it right, your crimp tool right up next to the back end of the connector and crimp right on down. Okay, sometimes you can crimp these a couple of different times. All right, and it's on. Now what you want to do is bring your strain relief boot up the jacketing, and it screws right on. Okay, now you're doing the same process after you're finished with all this. As far as cleaving, you just want to pass it over once or twice, do it with your hand, and it should be ready to pull right off. And it's off. Put it on your tape. Don't forget that all your excess stuff goes on that tape. Polishing paper got a little dirty here. That's another thing. If you're in a new construction site and you're one of the first people in, there's going to be dust flying all over the place. It's important that you try to keep your paper as grit-free as possible, and I mean by grit the dust that accumulates or falls from overhead whenever there's construction going on, or just guys sweeping up around you. You'll notice it right away as soon as you start to polish that it feels gritty. You can hear it. You can hear it gravelly sound. And what's actually happening is it's pitting and wrecking your connector face as you're polishing. So you really have to be careful in a new construction zone. The best thing to do is take a text wipe with some alcohol on it, and just or water, doesn't make any difference at this point. Just lightly wipe off that grit off your polishing paper. Or if you've got a can of air, you know, compressed air, it'll shoot that grit off your polishing paper also. Remember just not to, when you put the connector in the polishing puck, you don't place it all the way through the polishing puck and then set the polishing puck down on the paper. You let it fall. You let the gravity take its course. Okay, another good one. And that's what you use for cordage. That's what you, that's a procedure for putting connectors on patch cords. Okay, now then I would like to show you some things about the outdoor cable. That's a whole different animal altogether. There's a flooding compound in outdoor cable that has to be dealt with. It's a pain in the butt, but this is what it looks like. I'm going to strip off a little bit more of this jacketing for you so that you've got an idea as to what to use as far as tool-wise. It's not a simple procedure of just scoring the cable and bending it. There's a zip cord inside here that you need to get at, and it's not the easiest thing in the world unless you have something that's going to take this jacketing off real nice and easy for you. Let me do that right now, as a matter of fact. I'll show you what I have. This is a regular Stanley utility blade or utility knife. However, the blade is a almost like a rug cutting blade. If you can, you see the hook on that, okay? What you want to do with that hook is you want to get it into the jacketing itself of your outdoor cable. Okay, you want to watch where you've got your hand. I mean, obviously it's not the safest thing in the world to draw a knife towards your body. I know I cut off the thick of my thumb doing it. So you really want to be careful as you're proceeding with this, okay? Try to, if you need to, start like 6 inches down on the cabling itself. You can take your blade, okay, and score it all the way around. Snap the covering in half so that you can see on the inside, and then you can finagle this blade on the inside of that gash and hook it, and then start your procedure of cutting down this the length of this cable. Okay, but I've already started it up here to help myself. So what you want to get that, you want to get that in there. You want to be very careful about cutting towards your body, like I said. It's hard on a short piece here. But as you can see, it goes pretty. You're going to have to maybe take it out because it's going to get snagged up on the Kevlar periodically. So you might have to take it out and redo it. As you can see, it's just, and be very careful when you're doing this, because there really isn't a good way You know, if you have to hang onto this cable, your body's going to be in a position relative where the blade's at, and you really have to be mindful about that blade. Just do it a nice, even pressure. If you've got a sharp blade, that's another thing. Make sure your blade is sharp. People get hurt on dull blades. Take it from an expert. Okay, once you've got it stripped back, you know what you're going to be utilizing out of this fiber. You're done with your blade. You can actually peel this jacketing off. Okay, there you go. And it's a mess, let me tell you. Like I said, it's got that flooding compound in there. It's an icky pick style stuff, and anybody that knows anything about icky pick knows that this isn't pleasant work. Now inside this particular cable, it's got a cellophane wrap you're going to have to get rid of. Okay. It's always some of the other things that you require for this are plenty of towels, a liquid called hydrosol. That's what's going to get rid of the icky pick or the flooding compound. This is not easy. Okay, what you see now, you can see I've cut off a section of it already here. This is a central strength member. This is what gives it its rigidity. Okay, so it's not quite as flexible. All right, you really don't require, you don't need it at all, as a matter of fact. So you can peel this out of there, and you just counterclockwise or clockwise, you can take this right out. So you get it down to the point where it's back to the jack. You just take your dikes, cut that puppy off. Now you've got a twist of, this is a mini bundle, by the way. I think I explained a little bit earlier. You've got several bundles of fiber, all color-coded, okay? You got your blue, orange, green, brown, and then you have some more strength members that are wrapped around two each of these mini bundles, okay? So what you want to do is get those two strength members out of there again, and the only way to do that is to start unwinding the stuff. This is a time-consuming process. There's no fast way of doing it. You're just going to have to get it all separated. While I'm doing this, I'll make a note to you guys out there. It's once you get a little bit faster, and I'll show you a couple of different ways of being productive as far as the number of connectors you can do in the course of a day. But once you get going, once you get a rhythm, and the biggest most important part about all this is being organized, believe it or not. You know, if you've got some kind of style, and that's all it is style or method, as to how you like to set up your table. Like for instance, I think I made a mention of a table that I utilize. It's a subjecto stand. It's got collapsible legs, or telescopic legs rather. You can unscrew those legs, you can take it all apart, so it's real nice and thin and very portable. I can fit 72 connectors on that table, and I can get those done, I mean, starting from scratch, I can get those done before lunch, okay? And typically, if on a real good day, if everything is prepped and ready for me, I can do about 144. So, and that's after many years of doing this and finding out different ways of what's going to make me faster, because that's the bottom line for these contractors, as you probably already know, is they want production. And I'll show you a few steps a little bit later on, how to hold the fiber in your hand. I mean, I can hold 12 strands of fiber in my hand at once, putting on all the necessary components, the backing nut and the strain relief boot. And, I'm starting to pick up stuff here. This icky pick is exactly that. Nasty stuff. Okay. The pants do well. So yeah, I can hold 12 strands in my hand and get them connectorized within minutes after getting the coating on the outside of the fiber off. It doesn't take long at all. So I'd say 20 minutes start to finish, 12 strands. That's not including putting them in. I'm talking about stripping them, connectorizing them, polishing them. Then the process of winding them in this enclosure is a whole different time frame. So, and it depends on what kind of enclosure you have too. Some are a little bit easier to get inside than others. One thing is going to take a little bit longer than the next. It also depends on how the fibers are bundled. I think I said earlier that you can pretty much customize fibers, you know, depending on the packaging. You can buy just about anything out there. And there are many different kinds that you're going to run into. The job that I'm doing now is a 72 fiber job, and it's packaged in bundles of 6 fibers, so that's 12 bundles each, which is long and involved when each bundle has are wrapped around it and the cellophane packaging wrapped around it, and it gets to be long and involved, and you get your boss wondering why everything's taking a little bit longer than usual. Well, he doesn't realize that the packaging makes a lot of difference. Okay, once you've got this stripped down now and the strength members out of the way, you've got your mini bundles. You want to get your hydrosol. Okay, once you've got the hydrosol and the icky pick cleaned off, your next step is to cut into the outer casing, or the sheathing that houses these fibers. Typically, I would use at least this much inside an enclosure, okay? And then this much more for terminations. So you're looking for at an extra, oh geez, 1.5 feet. Or better, 2 feet of extra. So you really want, I'd say this is 3 feet, maybe up to 6 feet, 5 to 6 feet of this that you want to utilize. Well, like I say, for the purpose of the video here, we're going to make it as easy on me as possible. But you want to keep that in mind. You want a little bit extra in your LIU, your enclosure, so that you, if you should require any, you know, getting back to that service loop, if something should break or happen, you've got something to fall back on. Okay, so now you want a real sharp knife, utility knife. You want to just score this plastic. This is a real hard plastic. What you really need to do is just score it, okay? And it doesn't take any amount of pressure at all to score this stuff. And it snaps. Did you hear that snap? Okay, it snaps right in half. And now, you bring your hand back, you can pull the casing right off the fiber. You want it real slow. You don't want to jerk this. You don't want to, just take your time. Okay. If you can see the fiber glistening, that is another icky pick, a compound that protects the fibers from water, moisture, the outside elements. This is outdoor cable, you've got to remember. So just take your time pulling this outer casing off. You don't want to bust any fibers. Once again, I know from experience, I was in a hurry one day and I snapped two of the fibers off right at the very top here from pulling too hard. I've learned everything the hard way. Now with this, you want to get back to your hydrosol rag. You've got it nice and soaked. You want to take this this compound off your fibers. Generally, what I'm listening for or feeling for is a resistance. Once this starts to get squeaky clean from you using your hydrosol on this, is you'll feel it. You'll feel the resistance because now it's squeaky. Can you hear it? Once it starts to squeak, you know you've got it clean. Okay? And a few more passes will ensure that all of that icky pick or that flooding compound is off, because you really don't want to have to deal with that later, and I'll show you why. Okay, once you've got that cleaned, you want to dry it off. So get another paper towel, nice clean dry paper towel, and just kind of gently wipe clean or dry off the fibers, and you'll see them start to separate. When they start getting dry, you see them kind of fall apart. I don't know if you could see that or not. Okay, they just kind of fall apart. When that happens, they're usually dry enough to get the old rosin bag out. And that's something that will come, or you can purchase yourself. It's a bag with like baby powder or rosin inside of it. Now this, what you're going to use, you're going to apply it to your fibers. And the reason behind that is you're actually making your own breakout kit. You can purchase breakout kits for outdoor fiber from any vendor. And they'll cost you sometimes anywhere upwards from 100 to 100 and a half to 200. That's getting pretty expensive. What I do is I purchase from AT&T or Belden or whoever. I'll purchase the tubing, okay, the tubing from a breakout kit for the fiber. You need a protective covering over this fiber, so you just purchase the tubing for it and slip it on over the fiber when you get this resin on, so that this tubing will slip on a lot better. You need this resin. And you can wrap some tape around the edge right here, or you can slip over a boot of heat shrink, okay? That makes it look real nice. It's a matter of personal preference as to what you like to use. Personally, it's a lot quicker because I'm a production guy. I just go with the tape, cover it up, and then I'll put some spiral wrap around that. That gives it a nice protective coating, and nobody sees the tape, you know, so to speak. But if you really wanted to make it look nice, you could put on a little piece of heat shrink on over all the tubes that you've applied over your fiber onto the sheathing here, and then heat shrink it down with a blow dryer, for instance. It'll shrink right over that. Okay. So once you've got your resin, you just give it a couple of swipes. Okay. Now, if there is any of that compound or that flooding compound, that icky pick left on here, you're not going to get this tubing on. plain and simple. And chances are real good that if there's compound left up here closer to the where it comes out of the tubing, you get a snag right there, that's where it's going to break. That's exactly where it's going to break. Okay? So now you've got to completely start all over, because the rest of your fibers, they're worthless. You know, you can't, you've got to have all fibers available for this job. Now you've got to take your service loop, okay, take it out, strip off what you need out of your service loop. So this is really critical that you get that that compound off, because if it snags up in your tubing and you're pushing this tubing up over the fiber and it snags right at the very end, that's where it breaks. You're not a happy camper. Once again, this isn't for A-type personalities. So you've got your resin on. You take your tubing. What you want to do, or how you want to get a measurement for this, peel off 5-6 feet. Take your tubing, place it right at the point of entry where it's coming out of your jacketing. Run your fingers down, and you want about an inch and a quarter. That's where you want to make your cut. You want the fiber an inch and a quarter longer than the actual tubing. Okay? So you put your fibers down and snip. Don't use dykes on this. Okay? All dykes do on this kind of tubing is smashes one end. Then, you, like I just said earlier, your fiber doesn't get through that one end because you smashed it with your dykes instead of cutting it with your scissors. And now you run the risk of busting it way up here because you're trying to force that fiber through an end that's already smashed closed. So, once again, I learned that the hard way. Don't use your dykes. Cut it with your scissors. Now you want to take one fiber at a time, and you want to eyeball it. This is what you're doing with it. You're just sticking the fiber into the tubing and threading it down the tubing. Okay, and you just want to gently push it down. You don't want to grab onto that fiber and start really force feeding it, because like I say, if there is any of that flooding compound on, or that icky pick on it, it's going to get snagged up in here someplace, and now if you're force feeding it, you're going to bust it someplace. It's inevitable. It happens. So you just want to kind of lightly hold the fiber and gently force feed it down. If you run into a snag, sometimes it's because this tubing is curly cued up on you. Okay, you just want to kind of straighten it out as best you can. All right. If you need to, sometimes you can actually straighten this completely out, and then it'll feed itself if you gently push up on it. Okay? And now you've got your inch and a half of fiber past your buffer tubing. Okay? So this is just strictly a protective coating. After you've broken out the fibers out of your jacketing, out of the mini bundle here, you need some protective tubing. I've walked into jobs where they've actually just had this bare fiber laced around in an enclosure with connectors on the end. And I don't know. That's not the right way of doing things in my book. So you need this tubing on there. Okay, once you've got all the tubing on, what I do, like I said a little while ago, is I'll take a piece of tape and I will simply tape the tubing and the jacket that houses the fibers together. You know, this is nothing fancy. As a matter of fact, I've had complaints from fellow workers about this method of how bad it might look, but the bottom line is any enclosure that this goes into should never be opened, number one. You never want anybody getting inside of an enclosure where you've got fiber in it. There's absolutely no reason for it. Any data that's required of where fibers, which fibers are hooked up to where. In other words, if you're using 1 and 2 fibers, a patch cord running to router A, all that information should be on the outside of the door of your enclosure. Okay, I've seen a lot of people will stick information on the inside of an enclosure. Now that forces them to open that door up to that enclosure. Now the risk of a fiber falling out, getting in the way of a closed door, is it's there. You don't want that kind of a risk happening. So what I do is I'll slip, usually it's a smaller piece of spiral wrap around it, okay? And you just spiral it on. Okay? And you can take one whole piece and tape it right onto all needles. Okay? It gives it plenty of protections plus some flexibility. All right? But like I said earlier, if you want to take the time, and it does make it look a lot nicer, it's the way I used to do it, and that's to put the heat shrink on. You know, after you've got all your tubing on over your fiber, put the heat shrink on and shrink that down, and it makes it look real nice. It's a real sharp finished product. Okay, what we've just worked on is a cable that is typically known as a mini bundled cable. This particular cable's from Belden, and this is filled with, like I described earlier, 4 bundles: a blue, orange, green, brown. In each one of these bundles, there are 6 individual fibers. Okay, so in this blue bundle, if you can pan down to what I have here on the table, you've got a blue fiber: orange, green, brown, slate, and white. They're all color-coded, okay? After you have on your tubing, your breakout tubing, you want to take off that coating in preparation to put your connector on, okay? About 1/4 inch bite, it takes that coating right off, okay? Right down to your cladding. So the coating has been stripped away. You're down to your cladding now, and it is ready for termination.